property, our freedom, our rights, and our liberty. But to do this, we must shed conventional thinking regarding our political structure. We need to be revolutionaries in thought, dissidents in action. Only after we recognize what our government is doing to our freedom and our Constitution will we start taking it back. And this program is just about that. Today, we're pleased and honored to have as our guest today Laurence J. Kotlikoff, a William Fairfield Warren Professor at Boston University. He is a professor of economics and has been awarded a standing as one of the world's 25 most influential economists, and is one of mine as well, by the way. He is also a New York Times best-selling author, and we are certainly honored that he has accepted our invitation to return to our show. We may touch on a variety of subjects, but we will start with the healthcare crisis and see where we go with that and what the solutions are. Mm-hmm. Listen in and call in with your questions and comments, 646-652-4620. That's 646-652-4620. Remember to press the one button so we know for those people that are listening in via phone that you want to ask a question or make a comment. Professor Kotlikoff, thank you very much for returning to Liberty Talk Radio. It's our honor. Yeah. Now, I understand that you wanted to talk a little bit about your solution to this healthcare, I guess, conundrum more than anything else. We know it's a crisis. We know the solutions are all have loose ends on them. Some appear to be very attractive, but wind up being more expensive and not very effective. And so I'll start by saying, you know, with all of this, we have all of these politicians telling us all of the solutions, except I don't hear any of the doctors saying anything. And I don't want to hear the doctors come online and say, you know, if it was up to me, this is what I would do. But we'll leave that for later. Please, what say you regarding our solution?
That's about 6% of the interest on decide now that you're signed up with them, they're on the hook. So they have to decide how many MRIs to give you, how many appointments with GPs to have you come. You know, there's an incentive here that the insurance companies have to control the use of the healthcare system, but they also, because they're not going to get any more money, they've got your voucher, that's it. And they also have an incentive to get you back, because if they don't get customers back, they're out of business. So this is a very simple solution. It has a lot in common with the German system, apart from some of the language, the Swiss system, some other systems around the world. So it's a single payer insofar as Uncle Sam's giving the vouchers, but we'd all pay for the vouchers with our taxes. All right. So it's really multiple payers and multiple providers. And we would have an efficient tax system that would raise a lot of revenue to cover all this. So that's a very simple answer. The Republicans have to bite the bullet and say to Medicare people, look, you got to come in with everybody else. We're not going to treat somebody who's 84 better than somebody who's 3. When it comes to basic healthcare, there's a consensus in the country that everybody needs a basic policy. I know libertarians think that we should just let people, or some libertarians think we can just let people. Oh, sorry, my door just a little windy. Well, hang on, let me just shut this door outside. Hang on.
Folks, he'll be right back.
Some people think that everybody should be responsible for their own health. They should take care of themselves. They should eat better and exercise more, and they'll never get cancer. That doesn't happen in the real world. That's fantasy. Or that they'll never break their arm by slipping on the ice. So if you have somebody who's slips on the ice outside and they can't otherwise afford to pay for the doctor, and you had a fully libertarian system, I think all the libertarians around would go and help that person. And you know why? That's because of altruism, that concern for other people. So the basic proposition of altruism really is antithetical to libertarianism. I know you're a libertarian, but I just want to talk to you a little bit deeply about libertarianism. It has a basic fundamental contradiction inherent in it, which is that people love other people. They care about other people. And as soon as that happens, if I care about you and you care about, let's say I care about you and Joe over here cares about you, we both care about you, and then you have a basic market problem, failure problem, which is, should I take care of you or should I let him take care of you? We both want each other to take care of you, and then consequently, you don't get enough care, and we both end up worse off because you're not taken care of. So that's the basic free rider problem that arises under libertarianism with altruism. So I think the answer is, in these situations, is to compel people to get insurance. And if you give everybody a free voucher, they will all get the insurance. And then we go and we compel people to pay taxes in a reasonable manner on a progressive basis, but not crazy high rates. We do it efficiently. And there's also a plan for that in this book on my website, kotlikoff.net. And then we have the whole thing paid for. And it's not like Obamacare, where you earn more money, you lose your subsidy. It's not like Medicare, where if you earn too much money, you're all of a sudden paying these very high Medicare Part B premiums. It's not like Medicaid, where if you earn an extra dollar or even a penny, you could lose Medicaid coverage for your entire family. So there are these astronomical tax rates, especially in the case of Medicaid, that are keeping people from working. So we have to rationalize the system. It's efficient to give people the health care insurance for free and then tax them in an efficient way so they're not facing exorbitant tax rates. And we do this in a way that we get enough revenue. Now, that's my answer. And the key thing about why this works is that we keep the spending at 10% of GDP. The CBO under the current system projects it to go up to about 20% of GDP, which will totally bankrupt our children. You know, it's just too much.
Yeah, are you saying right now it's about 20% of GDP? Because I was going to ask you that question.
The spending on Medicare, Medicaid, Obamacare, and employer-based health care, the tax breaks, is about 7% of GDP.
So,
I think we need to go to 10% of GDP, and that will do it for a basic plan. If you look at Germany or Switzerland, they're spending about 12% of GDP on their entire healthcare system. So for 10% of GDP, I think we can get a very good basic plan for everybody.
So in effect, it would go up, right? It would go up from 7% of GDP to 10% of GDP.
Go up, but stay fixed.
Stay fixed, okay. Well,
okay, it wouldn't start low and go out the roof.
Yeah. May I respectfully just change something a little bit, just what you said. Libertarianism is the most selfish system in the world. It's not altruistic at all. People look out for themselves, right, and what's best for them. And if everyone in society did that, and if they were all libertarians, we would have a better society. So, yes, libertarians are very generous people, by the way. But inherently, it is a very, very selfish system, is that everyone is doing the very best they can for themselves and their family. That's what keeps the costs down. That's what keeps people from killing one each other, because everyone's watching out for themselves. And as a result, the result of that, you're watching out for society as a whole. But let's go back in time a little bit. We'll go back to 1942. Yeah. I'm sorry, Professor, would you say?
We should debate this some more on another occasion. But
oh, yeah, I realize that. I don't want to get off the, I don't want the train to go on a different track. But believe me, it's, in my opinion, incredibly unselfish. Now, I'm libertarian. I'm an avid libertarian, and I take a good portion of my money voluntarily, and I give it away.
So here's the, yeah, okay, but just one more thing to repeat. The problem is if you're trying to give charity to somebody like Joe, and I'm interested in Joe, and somebody else cares about Joe, we're all going to free ride on each other. We are not going to give, Joe's not going to get the optimal amount of charity, because we're going to all want the other person to take care of Joe. That's, you've heard of the Good Samaritan story in the Bible, right?
Yes.
Okay. You know, Jesus comes along, and or somebody comes along, Good Samaritan, gives money to this beggar. Well, economists like me, or my profession, we have identified something called the Samaritan's dilemma, okay? Which is that this Good Samaritan comes along the next day, and the beggar is out there asking again, okay? So we have to look at, so this Good Samaritan who's altruistic, he's going to potentially get taken. We have to worry about the incentive of the beggar in this case to take advantage of the Samaritan. We have to worry about the incentive of somebody else who cares for Joe to free ride on you who care for Joe. So this is a more complicated. I think that the weakness in libertarianism is that you guys are actually nice people.
Oh, well, wonderful. Well, not only that, but I'm good looking.
Exactly. Yeah.
I know, but that's a story from another program. Okay.
I think once you introduce altruism and this free rider problem, you have to get to, that's a public good problem, and you need collective action.
Well, you know what's interesting? Really, Professor, I know many libertarians, and every single one of them, that's an exaggerated statement, but for the most part, the libertarians that I know, even those that are unwealthy, if you will, I mean, just about that, are very generous people, and always take their time to help other people. So I'm just saying that human nature is such, when you don't force people to do anything and you don't put restraints on people, people will do the best they can for themselves, number one. And at the same time, whatever resources they have, they will help other people. There is no reason why I give thousands of dollars away to organizations, and this is, you know, medical organizations and whatever, you know, charities and whatever. There's no one holding a gun to my head whatsoever. No one would know. And they wouldn't even know if I gave, because they have so many donors, right? But I do it anyway. And I'm just saying that libertarians are misinterpreted. The concept of libertarians misinterpreted, you know, as being, oh, we're altruistic. No, we're not. We're very, very selfish, but we're very generous people. But I want to get on something else. You know, there's one principle that holds true, that if you have any process at all that can be done for a dollar, if you get the government involved, it now costs you a few dollars. There is no case in the world, I don't think you can name a case, where once we had a system going and the government got involved, where the price, real price, went down. Let me give you an example. The only reason why we have health care provided by many companies is because, you know, during World War II, companies could not increase the pay of that. There was a salary freeze, so you couldn't increase the pay of someone that you wanted to keep on staff because you were afraid they were going to go someplace else. You couldn't give them any more money. They said, "Well, we can't give them any more money," but the government did allow them to pay for certain things like health care. That's where the government health care was initiated. Now, the problem with that is that ever since, health care has been going up. The more government gets involved in health care, the higher the cost. I've had many prominent doctors on this program that have told me, and believe me, I'm not exaggerating this because I've done this myself on major operations that I've had, and what I paid out of pocket, although I have very good insurance, what I paid out of pocket, and then what was charged. And some of them will commit themselves to saying that health care is about 10 times more expensive than it should be. So my problem with all of this, all of these programs that I'm sure would be a lot better than what we have now, still involves the government. And when the government gets involved, the cost never goes down.
Hang on. My system is being run by a computer. There's not even a single government person involved. It can all be run by a computer. Okay, it's completely totally electric medical records. Yes, there would be a panel of doctors, but they have a simple system decision of what is going to be covered. Will this drug be covered or not? Can it be afforded by 10% of GDP? And then you have competition. So I'm getting the government out of the micromanagement of healthcare, having healthcare, basic healthcare, turned into a commodity just like apples or wheat. And this is a hyper-competitive solution, so you must love it. It's the free market goes.
Oh, so the government is not involved at all. Then I misinterpreted. The government is not involved at all. Am I correct?
The government provides the voucher, but it's done by a computer. It does the calculations and issues the vouchers. And then people choose to free to choose their insurance company, and the insurance company is on the hook. So the insurance company is going to tell these doctors, look, you can't see this person 40 times a day. Secondly, you can't have them MRI every 2 days, unless it's actually going to be important to give that person that the right level of care, because you want to get the person to come back. So you don't want to be just skimping either. Because people will be able to freely choose a different insurer at the end of the year.
All right, but who determines how much? Who determines how much a procedure would be? A person comes in and they need a whatever, and who determines that? Does the doctor determine that? The individual doctor, the individual hospital, or does the voucher system determine that?
The voucher system is going to give the insurance company a fixed amount of money. If you need to go get a heart valve, let's say you sign up with Kaiser Permanente, okay? It's an HMO held in California. Well, you'll go see a cardiologist there. He'll schedule the operation, and Kaiser will pay for the doctor, because the doctor's on a fixed salary. The doctor doesn't have an incentive to have extra operations. They'll pay for all the valve and all the medical, they own the hospitals. So it's all internalized. The whole pricing issues, the cost issues are internalized by Kaiser. So that's what I see the system evolving into. Everybody signs up with an HMO. And we'd be able to see, we're talking about nationwide HMOs, so companies operating across the country, insurance companies, and having networks of doctors and owning hospitals around the country and nursing homes and so forth.
If in fact I elect as a citizen of this country not to participate in this program, do I have that option?
It doesn't. Look, you get the voucher for free, and if you don't want to use it or go, you don't want to take it to an insurance company and sign up, you're just saving money for people.
Well, it's not free. It's got to be taken out of my taxes.
Yeah, that you don't have an option.
So in essence, I don't have an option. This is what I have to do whether I want to or not. I object to that.
Well, here's the thing. You're never going to get the insurance system to work unless you put everybody together in the same pool. You're never going to get everybody in the same pool unless you get them all to sign up. The only way you're going to get them all to sign up is if you give it to them for free. And then they all sign up, just like with Medicare. Essentially, that's free except for the Medicare Part B premiums, and there's a Part D premium. But basic Medicare Part A, everybody over 65 once they stop working is in Medicare Part A for sure. And that's because it's free.
Then why isn't the cost of Medicare medical care go from 7% of GDP to 5% and not 7% to 10%?
Well, Medicare would no longer exist. We would have just one basic plan for everybody in the country, and we'd spend 10% of GDP in total on it. And the old would not be treated better than the middle-aged, than the young. There's no reason to do that, right? Do we value... do we value somebody's 87 more than somebody's 3? Or somebody who's poor in 3? I don't think so, if we really think about our values. So this is a very simple solution the Republicans can run with, but they have to break some eggs. They have to get rid of employer-based health care, Obamacare, Medicare, and Medicaid. And this articulates something that will work for the long term. And, yeah, it'll be in, people will be worried and concerned whether they'll be able to see their own doctors, but the doctors will be connecting with networks of insurers, and they'll choose that insurer. So they should be able to retain their own doctor. No insurance company will be able to turn you down, and no insurance company will be able to offer supplemental policies unless they offer the basic plan. So now this proposal, as I said, it was developed by a good libertarian, John Goodman, who's the head of the Goodman Institute. That's out of Dallas. And so it's also been endorsed by 5 Nobel Prize winners, liberals and conservatives. It's been endorsed by hundreds of economists. If you go to thepurplehealthplan.org, there's a website I set up where people get to endorse this plan if they want to. And you'll see all the names of all the economists. So this is not that hard to do if you're aware of the issues as an economist. But when you have politicians trying to design healthcare, you get a mess.
I agree. I think we should get all the politicians out. And I think the economist should be commenting on it. But it should be the doctors who are making making up the rules. When I was young and someone was sick in my family, and I remember when I was sick, a doctor would come to my house, actually in the Bronx, New York. I mean, you don't want to walk the streets. And a doctor would come late at night, you know, give me a medicine, a shot or whatever, and go home. And it would be very inexpensive. Today, I mean, Bill Gates would have a hard time paying that bill. So my point being is that we had a system that actually worked. And then we got government involved saying, we have to cover everyone. My wife's an audiologist. She dropped out of the system. I mean, she doesn't take anything, Medicare, Medicaid, nothing. What she will do is she will do it for free if someone needs it. I get it. What do you say? What happened?
It did not work. It did not work for everybody. It worked for you. It worked for upper or middle class people. We've had uninsured people for decades. It did not work for everybody. Poor people who couldn't get insurance because they had pre-existing conditions or could not afford even a moderate policy, it did not work for them. So we have to do this in a way that works for everybody. We're now at a point where we have a consensus, including the consensus of, I think, libertarians, that everybody needs a basic policy and that everybody who can afford to should pay for it. But they don't have to pay for it through the healthcare system. They can pay for it through the tax system. It doesn't matter. We just need to have an efficient tax system that doesn't give you these big disincentives to working. Why should I work if I earn another dollar and lose Medicaid? That's ridiculous.
You're right. Right.
Or lose 15. So we need to understand the entire problem, which is getting everybody in the same pool, keeping a lid on the costs, getting the incentives right. And this is the very simple solution. It can be run by a computer. It can fit on a postcard, what I just told you, that 10 or 11 points. And economists on the left and the right think this is the answer. So let's make it the answer. Let's get the Republicans.
There's my problem again. Put me on. But there's my problem again, is that we talk about the economist or government officials or the elected officials or legislators. I want to hear from the doctors. I want a consensus of the doctors, not of the economists, professor.
You have the doctors don't know economics, okay? They're trained to do
it's their business. They have to know. They have to know the economics of their business. They have to know how much it costs.
Look at Tom Price. Look at the Secretary of Health and Human Services, a less informed person when it comes to how to fix the healthcare system. You could not find. Okay, this guy believes that everybody should get a voucher of maybe $1,000 or so, or $1,500, no matter what their pre-existing conditions are. When somebody's diabetic might need a $30,000 a year voucher in order to get basic health care because he's going to be expensive.
Right.
So this guy doesn't understand point one about health insurance, which is something called adverse selection, cherry picking. The fact that the insurance companies, if you just give this guy with $2,000 or $3,000 voucher and he needs a $15,000 or $30,000 voucher, nobody will insure him, or he'll get insurance that's really crappy. So crappy insurance is not better than no insurance. Now, if this administration wants to pretend that everybody's insured because everybody ends up with some piece of paper that says health insurance on top of it, but it provides no coverage of any degree, and that you have some people really sick and not getting taken care of, and others because they're wealthier are, that's not going to fly politically. The country is too well connected in terms of communications. It will see right through it. You can't lie to the public like that. So no, Tom Price, when it comes to economics, he's not even an F student. He's an F minus student, okay? And I've talked to a lot of doctors who think that there should be no health insurance at all. We should all just take care of ourselves.
Yes, hallelujah. Excuse me, go ahead. I'm sorry for interrupting you. I just had to say hallelujah, but go ahead, please.
It's a ridiculous idea that you're going to take care of yourself if you have cancer.
It's
a ridiculous idea.
You know, I know many doctors, doctor friends. I don't think, I really honestly don't believe they would ever turn anyone down.
They should stick to their job, which is being doctors. They're not in the business of being economists. They haven't studied economics. They haven't studied health economics. They don't know what they're talking about when it comes to economics as a general rule.
I think
lots of doctors. Yeah. I've talked to doctors at Harvard. I've talked to doctors in the countryside. They are not trained to answer this question. Just like I'm not trained to do your job, and I'm not trained to build a bridge across the Charles River here in Boston. I'm not trained as an engineer. So we should not pretend that somebody has no training that did not go to 4 years of grad school and then spent years studying the subject and looking at the data and figuring out in comparing other countries is going to know what to do. Just because, you know, they drive across the bridge, that doesn't mean they can build the bridge.
But any person in business for themselves are not typically economists. They go into business. Bill Gates is not an economist, and he became a multi-billionaire. My point being is that we keep on focusing on the economics. We should focus on medical care, and we're not doing that, Professor.
We have a billionaire as president right now, Donald Trump. If he were let loose on the economy, he would have. It's not clear what that he even remembers from one day to the next what he says, but his idea, at least at times, he has said we should have 45% tariffs on China, 20% tariffs on Mexico.
The guy's typically off the page, you know, I mean, as far as I'm concerned. I mean, you and I may survive this thing. You know that. Maybe we'll survive. I'm not sure.
He would produce a trade war overnight.
Absolutely. I agree.
The Mexican government is already figuring out how to boycott our goods.
Yeah.
Okay? How to send us a message. Okay? I've heard that today from somebody who has pretty high contacts. From somebody who was actually in the meeting with Tillerson. So they already have very definitive plans. You know, there's all kinds of cross-border trade where a product goes from the U.S. to Mexico, some part gets added, comes back to the U.S., gets another part, gets sent back to Mexico.
Right, right.
If they shut that down for a month...
Right, we're toast.
Recession.
Yeah, I agree.
We're going to have probably a worldwide boycott of tourism to the U.S. if Trump continues the way he's treating refugees and Muslims, because people around the world are sick of this guy already. Right. He's only been in office for about a month.
I agree.
So it's going to be a backlash. So don't tell me that a guy in business knows how to run the economy.
Oh, no, he doesn't. No, I'm not suggesting that at all. I'm saying, but they do get to know their own business, and they know how to maximize the business, and the only way they can maximize their business, I'm a businessman. The way I maximize my business is to maximize the profitability of my clients, because if I don't, someone else will, and then I'll lose that business. I'm not an economist, but I know that, you know? Now, you have to understand, you know, the reason why I'm giving you such a hard time. You ever hear that expression? You only hurt the ones you love. You know that. And that's why I'm giving you such a hard time, because I have utmost respect for you. But I just, healthcare, my wife's an audiologist. She used to take all these things, government things, you know, Medicare, you know, and she said, we went nuts, because what had happened is that the cost of the back room work was overtaking the cost of actually running the practice. So she says, not taking it. She just literally shut it all down. She said, if someone comes in, they can pay. If they can't pay, I'll find a way to do it for them. And you know what? That's exactly what she's done. And she's helped a hell of a lot of people. Didn't get any money for it. Helped a lot of people. And she's still in business. And she feels much better about it. What say you?
Well, what say I is that my proposal doesn't involve any backroom work. It's a computer is going to send you a voucher. The insurance company is going to get the voucher. They're going to swap it for money. And that's it. And then they're going to be on the hook.
Then why wouldn't the, amount of
there's no paper
why wouldn't the amount of health care for compared to GDP percentage to GDP actually go down if it's going to simplify everything and get rid of all this administrative gobbledygook? It's got to go down significantly, because I go to a doctor's office now, you're lucky to see the doctor. You see 25 people fill out forms before you see the doctor. It's got to be hellaciously expensive, and yet with this program it's going up. I don't understand that.
So listen to what I proposed, okay? 10% of GDP forever. Higher initially, fix it 10% of GDP forever. Rather than going up, staying where it is now, going up to 20% forever. Okay. So it will go down under what I'm talking about, because the insurance companies, all this wasted effort in paperwork and excessive treatment, that there's no incentives for that anymore. There's no need for it. And so we have a highly efficient system. Now, you've had lots of doctors in this country for years. They haven't proposed this. So the idea that doctors are going to come forward and propose something that's going to work, I haven't heard it. I haven't seen it. I took a PhD economist, John Goodman, libertarian, to think up this idea. I'm the one who's proselytizing it because it's the right answer. And then I modified it a little bit. I wrote a book about it. It's called The Healthcare Fix. And I've got this website, The Purple Health Plan, and it's in my You're Hired, a Trump Playbook for Fixing America's Economy, which is free for download at kotlikoff.net. So there's the solution. It's easy. You just have to tell people something that Donald Trump doesn't have the guts to do, because basically he's a coward. He doesn't have the guts to tell people that the country's broke, and we need to treat everybody the same when it comes to basic health care and not go broke. But we need to do it with the private sector's help. And we need to do it by getting rid of four dysfunctional systems and getting back to basics.
How many
here's the basic system.
How many jobs will be displaced as a result of this system? I would imagine by simplifying it, let me give you just one quick example. I went to a neurologist because I had a pinched nerve in my back. And and then he said, well, I suggest you go to this. He referred me to a specialist to give me a steroid shot. That's what it was. And but I had, you know, went to the hospital, was an overnight stay, everything done, filled out 1,000 forms and all that. He says, well, just go see this doctor. He gives the steroid shot. I went to see the doctor for the steroid shot. I'm not kidding you. I'm going to tell you the exact number of pages I had to fill out. 14 pages of medical history, of questionnaires or statements that I had to attest to. 14. This is after a physician, a neurologist who had worked on my back, referred me just to get a shot. My point being, and I was furious. When I told the doctor this, he stood there, he says, "You're right, it's, this whole system sucks." He wasn't even mad. He was with me all the way. But my point being is that how many people...
Wait.
Okay, go ahead.
Wait. If you look at my proposal, there's electronic medical records. Everybody would have the same electronic medical record system. So we'd have immediate access to your record. There's no forms for you to fill out because it's right there on the screen. And yes, this would be provided by the government. We'd have a national medical electronic record, medical records.
Can we do that? Can we privatize that, get it out of the government's hands because it's too expensive? The government does something, it costs 10 times as much. Can't we have companies doing it?
I just said that if you waited, I was about to say that it would be put out to bid by private companies.
Okay, like all right.
Athena Health. My wife works for Athena Health. They produce, they're a health tech company that does software for the health industry. They could provide this. So yes, we could bid this out and get a single electronic medical record system for everybody so we don't have to do all the stupid repetitive paperwork. So yeah, who's going to lose their jobs here? I think a lot of government bureaucrats, because all we need is one computer.
But what about the doctor's, office that has 18 people doing nothing but filling out forms and going, all these people have to lose their jobs because they're not going to be necessary anymore. That'll drive down the cost of health care tremendously and really should save us money and provide more health care. I agree with you there. But I wonder politically whether or not they have the guts to do that, knowing that 18,000 people are going to hit the streets looking for a job. Or whatever the number is.
We have to make some radical changes, structural changes, to really fix the economy, because otherwise we're heading down Argentina's path. You know, we're running this Ponzi scheme of taking from the young, giving to the old, leaving most of the obligations off the books, and we're going to run dry, you know, bleed our kids dry. We're doing that already. So that's the reality. We need new ideas for how to fix things, and I think this is the answer, so I'm glad you're supporting it.
Well, no, I agree that it is a giant step forward, a giant step in getting government away from the healthcare system, becoming more privatized, you know, with some funding from the government, which of course I disagree with again, but I'll buy into that. And I agree that it is superior to what we have now. And if we can do this, we would make life easier for everyone in the United States and possibly save this country. So I'm in agreement. I would just like to go that one step further and just privatize the whole damn thing. But okay, but before we go, hold on, we have a caller? All right, what the area code?
918.
All right. Caller, area code 918, you're on the line, and your question or comment, please, for Dr. Kotlikoff.
Hello.
Yes, caller, you're on the air. Area code 918, you're on the air.
Yes. I'm not sure if you had already covered this, but had you seen that the cash-only hospital in Oklahoma City has been in the news recently, last month in Time Magazine, and this month, I can't remember, but I saw it on a national news show that they actually have an a la carte price list of what it costs to get a surgery. And, of course, it's exponentially cheaper than if you go through your insurance. Have you discussed that?
No, we haven't discussed it. And I'm sure that that's, you know, for people that can afford that, that's great. And, that provider could certainly get into this business under my plan, but I don't think it's an answer for the entire country that each person pay out of pocket, because if you get cancer and you need $300,000 worth of procedures over 4 years and you have $30,000 in savings, you'll die. And even if they make the price $150,000, you'll die. That's not an answer. The altruistic libertarians.
Well, obviously there are
libertarians won't let you die.
But in many instances, it seems like that is at least one way to go at it. But
It's not an intelligent way to go about it. You cannot save for cancer operations. You can't save for your house burning down. You cannot save for insurable events. You have to have insurance. And that's another area where economics makes things very clear what's involved. And doctors know nothing about these issues when it comes to economics of insurance, economics of risk. So doctors are not the answer. And this company is maybe making, or this hospital may be making a name for itself and doing some good, but it's not an answer for 330 million people around the country. Anyway, I'm going to have to head off. I really appreciate our conversation.
All right, Professor, and, thank you. So, caller, thank you very much for calling in. Professor, thank you. I'm sorry. I was going to ask you a couple more questions, but since you have to leave, we'll let you go. I hope after today you will accept my invitation to return at a later date.
I will. Absolutely.
Okay.
It's been good.
All right, Professor, thank you so much for being on our show. Folks, Professor Laurence Kotlikoff, William Fairfield Warren Professor at Boston University, economics professor, and one of my favorite economists that I like to disagree with. Okay. Thank you very much, Professor. Appreciate it very much.
Listen to the show again. I think you'll come around and agree with it.
Okay. I probably will. Okay. I agree with you. Okay. Folks, this is the end of today's broadcast. Okay. We'd like to thank our sponsors for the financial support, and we'd like to thank you for listening in. You can further the cause of liberty by recommending this program to your friends and let us hear from you. Our email address is comments@libertytalkradio.com. Remember, as my wife was saying, you're either allowing your liberties to be taken away or you're striving to protect them. Unfortunately, there is no middle ground. Until next time, this is Joe Cristiano. You've been listening to Liberty Talk Radio. Stay well. Stay tuned.